national, state, and local races. Join us for news, interviews, and analysis. We'll have a full roundup on the morning show Wednesday at 7 a.m. That's Super Tuesday election coverage beginning at 7 p.m. on KPFA 94.1 FM.
Marhaba, this is Jihad, inviting you to join me in this rare opportunity to hear Dr. Mustafa Barghouthi, direct from Palestine, a human rights leader, founder of the Palestinian Medical Relief Committees, and a colleague of Professor Edward Said.
Dr. Barghouthi is speaking in Berkeley on Sunday, March 7th at 7 p.m. at King Middle School, 1781 Rose Street, with activist poet Maria Poblet. This is a benefit for the Middle East Children's Alliance. Call area bookstores for tickets or visit www.meccaforpeaceoneword.org or call
510-548-0542. You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno. It's 201. Stay tuned for About Health with Dr. Michael Lenore.
Good health and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenore. Today we're going to be talking about, once we get our music off, we're going to be talking about foot problems. Our special guest is, as usual, our most valued faculty, Dr. Michael DiGiacomo, who is a podiatrist, a specialist in foot disease. And so if you've got a foot problem, if you've got an ankle problem, if you've got things that you want to talk about in relationship to the foot, let me tell you, this is usually one of our more popular segments. So we want you to join us at 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. Before we get started with Dr. DiGiacomo, I want to mention a special event that we're doing tonight on KMTP television on Channel 32 at 9 p.m. We're going to have a live, what you call, town hall meeting on talking about the issue of ethnic health disparities, focusing primarily on the African-American community, but looking at all minority communities. You're welcome to join us on Channel 32 on almost every system. It's Channel 32, so we'll be there at 9 o'clock. You'll have a chance to call in. Our special guest will be Dr. Tony Eaton, who is the medical director for Alameda County. Talk a little bit about Proposition A. Dr. Mark Smith, who is the CEO and president of the California Healthcare Foundation. And Woody Carter, who is with the Bay Area Black United Fund. So talk about not only the whole issue of what's going on in terms of disparities in Alameda County, but also talk about with Dr. Smith about the whole issue of health disparities and what it means, and maybe get a little bit into healthcare reform, and talk a bit with Mr. Woody Carter about solutions to the problem. So that's tonight, Channel 32, 9 p.m. It's a live town hall meeting. All right, is Dr. DiGiacomo with us yet, or is he on the phone? Dr. DiGiacomo, are you there?
Yes, sir. How are you?
You got your sleeves rolled up?
I have.
You got your shirt unbuttoned?
I'm ready to rock.
You're all ready to go. Okay, let's always start with the question we always started with, which is what you're excited about in podiatry these days.
You know what, we talked about this before, but I've got even a new advance on this thing, and we talked about shockwave therapy for people that have heel pain or plantar fasciitis and or heel spurs. And most people get better with a stretching exercise, an orthotic to wear in their shoe, and occasionally physical therapy, and occasionally a splint that they wear day and night. For those recalcitrant cases, we've been using this shockwave therapy called the Ositron. This is technology borrowed from the kidney doctors, the urologists, and this was used initially to break up kidney stones. So it progressed from a thing where a person had to be into a large bathtub down to a little bag of water against their flank, and it got simpler and simpler, and all of a sudden they started thinking about other applications for it. So we've been using it for plantar fasciitis and heel spurs. The disadvantage of the thing had been in the past that it was somewhat of a blind procedure. In other words, we had a tube that was making a shockwave aim at the foot, and we didn't exactly know where the heel spur was because, you know, you couldn't have x-ray going on during the time you're using the machine. We got good results with it, but we're getting even better results now because we have a new machine and we can do ultrasound diagnostic imaging at the time we're doing the shockwave therapy, so we can actually see where we're delivering the therapy. And this makes the thing much more accurate and much more efficacious or effective. And I'm really excited about it. It's fun. It's a lot of us have seen the ultrasound image of a baby before they're born and the picture of the heart. Sometimes the cardiologist will do that. So we can actually see the heel spur or the enlarged plantar fascia and work on it with imaging live.
Well, you know, I'm going to start out by asking you one of my own questions. Now, I've got this little pain underneath my foot, right between my, it looks like my third and fourth toe. And it hurts when I walk on hard surfaces. Now, when I wear my good Rockports, you know, there's very little pain, but it's almost like something sticking up there in between my, just at the base of my fourth and fifth toe. I mean, third and fourth toe.
There is something sticking up there, and what you've got is you've got probably a prominence on one of those, we call it the knuckle bone or metatarsal heads, and that is pinching the nerve that runs between those bones. Mankind is set up in a curious way with the anatomy. On the bottom of our foot, one of our listeners just turned your hand over now and looked at the palm of your hand, and you drew a line that sort of split between the index finger and the thumb, there's one nerve that does that. It sort of splits and goes between the big toe and the second toe. When you get all the way over to where you are, we have a nerve that comes from the right side of the foot, a nerve that comes from the left side of the foot. They go between the two areas you're talking about, the two knuckle bones, and then it splits, so therefore it's a slightly wider nerve. It's two nerves that come together and then they split. And it's very common in mankind to get a little pinched nerve in that spot. And oftentimes if you're wearing something that's stiff, you don't get as much motion, therefore the nerve doesn't get drug against the ligament that sits below it, and it doesn't irritate it as much. We typically treat that with an orthotic insert in the shoe with a little teardrop-shaped pad on it that separates those two knuckle bones and takes away that neuritic-type pain.
All right. Well, I'll hustle on by there, get my little orthotic, and I think I'll be rolling at that point. All right, 848-4425 is our number, 510 area code. Our special guest, Dr. Mike DiGiacomo. Always a very good guest for those of you who have foot problems. Let's start with Peter in Fairfax. You're on About Health.
Hello.
Hey, Peter. How you doing?
So, I'm almost 60 years old, and I've been told what I have is a fallen metatarsal arch, particularly on the left side and lesser degree on the right side. So after having worn Rockports and kind of gotten by for a number of years, I've actually gotten prescription, custom-made orthotic inserts, which give a support to that arch to keep some curvature there instead of having it flatten out. But even so, after a few hours on my feet, I still get a lot of pain, and so I wind up actually having to wear the insert for a while and then taking it out just to have something different for a while and then putting it back in, kind of alternating. Is there, and I've gone through several rounds of adjustments on the orthotic, so do you think that it's still just not adjusted right, or
well,
is there something more I can be doing?
Let me ask you a question. If you look down at your feet when they're on the ground, do your toes bend upward a bit like what we call a hammer toe formation?
I'm looking at them right now, and a little bit. I mean, they're on the floor, but they go up to one knuckle and then back down at the tips.
Okay, so you have a minor hammer toe condition. So, and you told us your age was 60, did you say?
Yeah.
Okay, and your orthotic material is what? What is it made of?
It's a composition of cork and heavy foam and more spongy kind of foam.
Okay, if the doctor feels that there has been nothing else, there's nothing else that could be done in the way of adjustment, then you might have to go to, by the way, how tall and what's your height and weight?
6 feet and 170 pounds.
Okay. You may need to consider going to something that's a little more rigid than that can, by the way of that, I mean the material that it's made of, that can exert an even greater influence in elevating that transverse metatarsal arch. This, by the way, for our other listeners, this is the arch in our foot that goes from right to left under the ball of the foot. And sometimes something a little bit more rigid than that can do the trick. Now, if that fails, if all else fails, you may have to have the doctor entertain the thought of releasing those hammer toes by lengthening the tendons that go to them. That then will drop some of the pressure off of the ball of your foot.
Is there anything I can do by way of massage or exercising to help in that direction?
Yes. Try to take the ball of your foot and sort of raise it up towards your face while at the same time you're pushing down the first bone in the toes towards the ground. And you're trying to stretch those tendons I was just talking about. And in addition to that, you can sort of reproduce the arch. In other words, the arch is sort of like an egg shape on the bottom pushing upward.
Uh-huh.
And it goes right to left. So you could reproduce that. You could push that up
so this
after you've worked with those tendons on the toes some.
So this is like an accentuation of what the orthotic insert is trying to do.
Exactly right. And this is best done after you've warmed up with a bath or shower type of thing.
All right. Thank you for that question. Let's go to Guinevere in San Francisco. You're on About Health.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call.
Mm-hmm.
Great show. I have a question about toenail thickness, but I just wanted to say that I, for many years, would have great pain and from, you know, not wearing the proper arch support. And like he was just suggesting, I went to a store on 9th Avenue over in the Sunset District. And for the first time, you know, these days, we don't have people who actually, remember, you know, when you were a kid, people would feel, you try on shoes, they feel your foot, where's your toe, you know. And now people are on their own for buying shoes.
Sure.
You know, and I really think that has a lot to do with it. And for, you know, I go over there to buy the, because they have a huge selection of the inserts. And I, of course, don't have health care that covers, you know, seeing a podiatrist or whatever. And so I go over there, and he has me take off my shoes, and he watches me walk away. You know, and this is just a clerk in the store, and he goes to the wall, gets them. And, I mean, I used to have so much pain every morning and just all that, and now I don't have any.
Great.
You know, and those I'm able to put them into different shoes or whatever. But my question is, I do health care where I take care of an older woman, and so I maintain her feet, and she has incredibly thick toenails. I mean, I'm talking like half an inch thick or whatever.
Sure.
And I was just wondering what that's about and if there's anything.
Well, what happened was she had what was initially probably a low-grade athlete's foot type infection or fungus infection in the skin that eventually got into the toenails.
Ah.
And the problem is that at this point, it's the only treatment for that is to take an oral medication, which her doctor would have to weigh out with her as to what other medication she's taking and what her general health is.
Right.
But for our other listeners, you know, to be proactive and to try to get attention as soon as you see a peculiar-looking nail or an edge of a toenail is the way to go to avoid this unfortunate picture that's just been portrayed for us.
All right. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Let's go to Charlie in San Francisco. You're on About Health. Charlie? All right. Who's next? Is Ira from Oakland? You're on About Health. All right, let's go back to Charlie from. It's like a game here, Charlie.
Hi, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Oh, hi. I'm calling in. Thanks for the show. I'm calling in because I'm only 31, and I've noticed in the last 6 months that I'm starting to get strange cramps in my left foot, especially when I wake up in the morning and you know, first step on the floor. It's really, really painful. I've always worn super sensible shoes. I mean, when I was a kid, it was Birkenstocks and. Now I wear mostly like tennis shoes or boots, but only comfortable wide shoes. And I do have like a snake toe, like a toe that curls under my other toes, the toe that's next to my baby toe.
Right.
And I was wondering if that could be my problem.
No, that toe is called a congenital curly toe. It's almost always the toe next to the baby toe, and that is exceedingly common. And if anyone would have been really looking at your feet carefully, they would have seen this literally the day you were born. It just becomes more apparent.
No, they did. It was the first thing my aunt said when I came out. Has my toe.
So your aunt's backing me up on this story. So the bottom line is what you're probably experiencing is a tightness in your Achilles tendon that is manifesting by a pull on the muscles on the bottom of your foot. And for all our listeners, anatomy-wise, the bottom of our foot is not just a big fat pad. There are four layers of muscles under there. And sometimes you can get a quirk where your Achilles tendon gets tight, and that will pull on those muscles, and it will make a cramp type happen. So what you do for this cramp type symptom is when you get out of bed in the morning, immediately lean, put your foot flat on the ground, and lean to the wall with your hands on the wall, and keep your make this your back leg, your front leg moves towards the wall, and you bend your front knee. Keep your heel on the ground, keep your knee locked, and lower yourself to the wall, you know, lower your chest to the wall until you feel it real tight in your calf muscle. When you get down so far, you say, I cannot go anymore. Blow all your air out. Pretend you're in yoga class and count to five very slowly, about a 10-second hold.
Okay.
If you will do that every morning about five times on each leg and also do it in the evening, give that 2 weeks, and I can almost assure you that's going to go away.
Super. Thank you so much, doctor.
All right, thank you. 848-4425 is our number, the 51 area code. We're talking to Dr. Mike DiGiacomo. Let's go to Shem in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hi, doctor.
Hi.
This is Shem in Oakland.
How you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. My feet are giving me multiple issues.
Well, that's why we're here.
I've seen my general doctor at Kaiser. He didn't send me to the foot specialist. He's going to send me to a neurologist for one of the problems.
All right, let's hear the first
problem is plantar fasciitis. I've had it for at least 10 years. It's never gotten very bad. I've never had the bad heel pain, and I've got orthotics, and I use really good running shoes. And what's going on is that seems to be getting worse. Sometimes I feel like I'm walking on rocks unless I've got a brand new shoe. And also at night I get tortured with really hot feet, and I've got numbness.
Okay, so
on the outer toes and in the outer part of the foot.
When you have numbness in the outer part of the foot and the outer part of the toes, almost universally, that is a nerve root in your spine. I'm sure your doctor is doing the appropriate workup for that. So that we're going to put on the back burner. On the front burner, with the plantar fasciitis, you should be doing the stretching exercise that I just described on a daily basis, wearing your orthotics, and you should be put into a boot. It looks like a large ski boot called a CAM, C-A-M, Walker, W-A-L-K-E-R.
Absolutely.
Wear that day and night for 30 days. If you do not get better, you ask your provider to get you an Ositron treatment set up and get over this condition.
So CAM and Ositron.
CAM Walker for 30 days, day and night, and then the Ositron treatment if that fails.
Okay.
All right, thank you for that question.
Thank you.
All right, let's now go to Penelope. You're in North Fork. You're on about, I'm sorry, Penelope, you're on About Health. Penelope? Okay, let's go to Larry in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Right. Well, the last couple of years, I've been having trouble with my left foot, top part of the front half. And what happens is it starts aching so bad in the middle of the night, it wakes me up. And so I just lay real still, and after about a couple hours, it goes away. But I notice, though, that when it's aching, if I just reach over and just barely touch it, it hurts like hell. And then my right foot, I was on a ladder, and I fell, and I twisted in the rung of the ladder, and so I'm having a little trouble with that on the top part of the front part of my foot. So I was wondering, what is this on my left foot? I just barely touch it, and it hurts like that.
Yeah, Larry, typically what happens in a case like that is we develop very small, subtle bone spurs on the top of the instep. It's very common. It happens with aging. And those little bone spurs stick upward, and the nerve that covers that area of your foot that you're describing gets pinched by these things. And so oftentimes when we're lying down, you know, it's the quiet time of the day and our symptoms will become more manifest because, you know, you're not concentrating on so many other things. And sometimes just the bed sheets and covers alone, putting pressure on that nerve can exacerbate this or make the symptom worse. So it's sort of a little pressure-induced neuritis that is going on and not exceedingly uncommon. You probably do need to see a podiatrist on that, get an x-ray, and then they can tell you how big the things are and then address the treatment from there. But it's really easily treatable if you don't let it get so bad that you're just having day and night symptoms.
What about the right foot, the one that I twisted?
Well, of course, we can't tell without looking at it. Do you have much swelling or black and blue to
the
area?
No. Well, I had a little bit, but it went away a long time ago.
Oh, yeah. Well, I would say, you know, the thing on that is you've got to have somebody assess the ligament strength on the outside of the ankle. That's the weakest part of our ankle.
Yeah.
And if they find that you have some weakness over there due to the injury, ask them to give you a peroneal, P-E-R-O-N-E-A-L, muscle strengthening program. You get a piece of rubber band or TheraBand, and they can bring the strength back and make the symptoms much better on that torqued or twisted ankle.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
You bet.
All right. Thank you very much. Let's go to Sherry. You're on About Health.
Hello.
Hi. It's your turn.
Hi. This is a great show. Thank you. On my right foot, my toes are now all going to the left, and my big toe is like bent down in half.
Okay, and this is so your big toe is also going to your left?
Yeah.
And how about your hands? Any deformities going on there?
No.
And no history of injury to the foot?
No, I did have a bunion operation, and they said maybe it was that they could get like this after you've had a bunion operation in later years.
Okay, so what has happened, just for our other listeners, a bunion is a bump at the base of the big toe. And with that, the big toe usually migrates towards the baby toe side of the foot. So what has happened in your case is that you've had, it sounds like, an overcorrection of the bunion deformity. And so your big toe is sort of going out like our thumb would do. And the big toe is sort of a strut or a bolster to keep the other toes from migrating that direction. So when the big toe gets overcorrected, the other toes can naturally do this. So that's always good to give a history, because when you first stated your problem, it was sort of hard to figure it out. But now that you've told us the issue.
Well, it wasn't like that at first. The bunion operation was like 25 years
ago. Yeah, and what happens is it's an imbalance in the muscles, and they've got it just slightly tighter on the inner side of your foot. And it takes time for it to just ever so slowly pull that big toe out. And then it takes more time for those other toes to feel that there's no strut there to hold them straight.
And said I had hammer toes, too, but they didn't say what to do about it. Or
well, you need to see a podiatrist who does surgery, and you need to get that looked at and see if you can get it corrected. That should be relatively easily correctable if it's been that slow in progressing. So my advice is get in to see a good surgical podiatrist and have somebody look at fixing it that for you.
Okay, thank you a lot.
All right, thank you very much. Let's go to Ira. You're on About Health.
Yeah, hi, thank you. I have a problem with, I guess, what's a bunion after years of wearing shoes too small for my feet because I have big feet and I was being vain. I've developed what I guess is a bunion on my big toe, a large bump in the bone at the first joint. And I correct it with a little rubber insert, but I'm wondering if anything short of surgery will keep me from having to wear that insert forever.
Well, I hope the first thing you've done is the obvious, and that is get into more appropriate
yeah.
size shoes these days.
Yes.
And what I want you to do is take your opposite shoe and put it beneath that foot that has the bunion on it and line up, you know, where the ball of the foot and the heel of the foot is and pull upward on the sole of that shoe and find out if your foot is any wider than the sole of that shoe. If it is, you're still not in a wide enough shoe. So your first proactive thing is to do that. Your second proactive thing to do is, you know, most Americans, unfortunately, about every decade of life means about another 10 or 15 pounds. So if by any chance you're carrying much more weight than you should, back off on the weight, because that can help exacerbate or make a bunion get worse quicker. And the next thing is, aside from putting the rubber thing between your first toe and your second toe as you're doing, you could purchase a device that basically harnesses the foot and harnesses your big toe, and there's a little Velcro strap that will pull the big toe outward. And this is usually basically only worn at nighttime, very obviously, because you can't have your big toe pulled out or it's going to bump against your shoe during the day. So those are the proactive things you could do that are non-surgical. The other thing that you can do is if your foot is very flat in the arch on that side, then you should see a podiatrist about getting custom orthotics, because it is usually the flatness of the arch in conjunction with something like inappropriate shoe wear that has created your bunion.
Great, thanks. I didn't quite follow what your process was on the putting my left foot against my right foot. The right
okay.
foot is a bad one.
So take the shoe off your good foot.
Yes.
Put the sole beneath the bunion foot and pull upward on the shoe. In other words, the shoe is now upside down beneath your foot. And when you pull up on it, you're making your foot spread, and you're finding out if your foot stays within the confines of the sole of the shoe. That's how you know if the shoe's wide enough to not make your bunion get worse.
I see. Okay. All right, good.
All right, thank you very much. 848-4425 is our number. Dr. Mike DiGiacomo is our guest. Podiatry is our topic. Let's go now to Avery in Bay Point. You're on
yes.
About Health.
I wanted to clarify. Did you say that this directed shock therapy helps to reduce or eliminate heel spurs?
The symptom of heel spurs that is called plantar fasciitis, the answer is yes.
Okay, I'll have to tell that to a lady friend of mine who lives in Alabama. I'd like her to be up and dancing a little more when I see her next. And to that end, I also wanted to ask you if I want to do foot massage on her, is there anything particularly I should be cautious about?
No, anything that feels good. Uh-huh. Typically when you're doing the massage, though, I would start at the heel, push towards the toes, and gently raise the foot towards the face as you're doing that, so you're stretching as you're massaging.
Push the heel towards the toe?
No, start the massage at the heel and
okay.
gently push your fingers more towards the toes.
Okay.
And then as you're doing that, gently push the foot upward towards the face, so you're making a stretch happen when you're doing the massage. Mm. And that should be helpful.
All right, thanks. This is a lady, of course, who asks a lot of her feet, so I feel like I should be of some service to her in that regard.
So it sounds like you've got the equipment now and the tools to do that. So,
okay. But,
all right, now let's go to Keith in Walnut Creek. You're on About Health.
Hi. I've been under the care of a podiatrist. I've had custom arches made. I've been doing this for a number of years. But I broke my ankle when I was 19. I'm 56, and it's really coming back to haunt me now. And not particularly in the ankle, but an upper part of the foot. I saw in the x-rays, and he commented on that arthritis has developed in there, and it's become, like, extremely painful. He adjusted the arches, and it relieves some of the pressure. But I'm just wondering what kind of, if there is any relief or treatment for arthritis that's developing. And I've read about it becoming a debilitating type of a situation.
Now, is the arthritis more in the instep on the inner, the top of your foot, or is it more the ankle, would you say?
It's the top of the foot.
Okay. First of all, when you look at the x-ray, did you see a lot of your regular bones in there, or just one diffuse little, thing sticking up, like a little bone spur sticking up?
They weren't bone spurs sticking up. It seemed like there was, at the top of the foot, it almost seemed like they kind of like merged together a little bit, an area, let's say a gray area that was
uh-huh.
about an inch or so.
Well, if orthotics haven't done it for you, the next thing you can do on your own is what we mentioned at the last, maybe two callers ago, and that is if you're carrying extra weight, get that weight off, because that's going to help a lot, because this is a progressive thing. If you cannot get relief, and this is starting to limit your lifestyle such that you are not getting cardiovascular fitness, I would advocate seeing a surgical podiatrist. And what they can do in that case is if it's more of a superficial arthritic change, which is just on the top part of the bone structure, that can be simply planed down surgically, a very simple procedure. If it's much more involved, which you'd require like a CT scan to understand, for the doctor to understand how deep this goes, you may require surgery whereby the bones are fused, which is a bit more debilitating. There has to be hardware put in, and you have to wear a cast for a couple of months. But in the long run, you can get rid of that pain.
Yeah, but doesn't fusing the bones also stress the other joints as you are kind of hobbled because you don't have the flexibility?
The joints you're talking about are joints that are all sort of interlocked like little Legos.
Yeah.
They don't move like your big toe joint or your other toe joints or your fingers.
Mm-hmm.
So fusing these does not do that. Now, if, for instance, you had a really bad ankle and someone said to you, let me fuse your ankle, that's a much different thing because that then starts stressing your knee.
Oh, I see.
But these joints actually, if they had to be fused, can be fused somewhat with impunity as long as the surgery goes well and not worrying so much about the joints further towards your toes or up your leg going away.
Yeah, because I looked at the ankle and it was pretty clear compared to, I've looked at this stuff. But, okay, well, that's reasonable. There's nothing else that you can do for it, like the glucosamine. I've been trying to pump that stuff up.
The studies on the glucosamine have come in and they're very good, but it's only so far shown to be preservative for knee cartilage. Not so much for these joints. These joints have much smaller cartilage amounts in them.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a believer in glucosamine. I take it myself for knee issues. But as far as for what you have going on, I have no concrete evidence of it being helpful.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
You bet.
All right, let's go to San Francisco. Talk to Mary. You're on About Health.
Hi, I'm calling because...
Can you turn your radio down, Mary?
Uh-huh.
Can you
Is
turn
that better?
Yeah, that's better.
I am calling because I have a pinky toe that just started swelling up a few weeks ago, like randomly. I thought it was maybe it was just from my shoe, but it's gotten larger, got pretty large. It's almost in one area twice the size of my other toe, red and inflamed. And now it looks almost like a blister, but it's firm. And I did go to a podiatrist and they gave me some anti-inflammatories and had me wrap it and try and just kind of baby it, Epsom salts and that sort of thing. But it hasn't gone down at all. And I'm kind of wondering what's going on.
How old are you?
I'm 27.
And are you taking any medications of any kind?
The birth control pill.
Okay, nothing besides that, however?
No, not really.
Okay. The reason I ask that is because some people are put on what's known as a diuretic or a water pill to lower blood pressure. What that does is lower the amount of fluid in your blood, and that can make you get something called secondary gout, which sometimes will manifest like what you're talking about. But what you need to have done, and I would have it done sooner rather than later since you're so young, is get some blood tests. And the blood tests need to be a rheumatoid panel to find out if, in fact, you have some sort of a manifestation that is a rheumatoid-type illness that is just starting to show. The other thing is, did you have an x-ray taken?
Mm-hmm, they did, because she thought maybe it was broken or something, and there was nothing wrong with the,
okay.
You know.
So the x-ray is the first thing, because some rheumatoid-type illnesses will manifest on an x-ray, but sometimes they won't early on, and yours sounds fairly early on. Yeah. So you need to go back, and they need to do a sedimentation rate, a complete blood count, and they need to do a rheumatoid panel and figure out what's going on there. So this is not something where you just want treatment. You know, you don't want to just throw an anti-inflammatory at it. You want to get to the bottom of it and find out the cause.
That's what I thought. Can you please relist those three?
Oh, sure. A complete blood count? a sedimentation rate, and a rheumatoid panel.
Rheumatoid panel. And a sediment count?
Sedimentation rate, or just SED rate.
Okay.
I think it's called ESR.
Or ESR, sure.
Okay.
All right, well, thank you very much for that. Let's go to Fresno, talk to Ali. You're on About Health.
Hi. About a year ago, I got in a car accident, and I crushed my calcaneus bone, and I had an ankle fracture, and there was just my foot was really damaged. And I had the surgery done where they reconstructed the calcaneus bone, and they put a plate and three screws in there.
Yeah.
And I had x-rays done about a month ago, and the plate is starting to, it looks like it's starting to come out of the bone. And I'm having, you know, a lot of pain. I'm on strong painkillers and muscle relaxers because I work all day pretty much.
Are you in more pain now than you were, say, 8 months after surgery?
Yeah,
okay,
definitely.
Then that actually is fairly reassuring. So it means you probably got the bones to fuse.
Uh-huh.
But the plate needs to come out. And that's not uncommon for all of our other listeners. Having a heel bone crush or fracture is sometimes a very devastating problem because the heel bone is sort of like an egg. Once you crack it, it's hard to put all the pieces back together.
Yeah.
The other thing is it's got a thin shell, but the center of it is basically just marrow cavity. So when you put hardware in there, frequently that hardware will work its way loose after the job has been done. So it's not uncommon to have that hardware removed. And that should be a pretty simple procedure where they can just numb your foot if you want to be awake and just remove the hardware and just protect you with a soft cast or a removable cast for about 2 or 3 weeks.
I was told when I got the first surgery, after they did it, my surgeon told me that it was most likely that they're never going to take the metal out. They didn't want to take the metal out. And then when I got the x-rays done, my regular doctor told me that the possibilities were that I would get a fake, I don't know how he put it, but it was fake ankle joints in my whole foot. And I was kind of confused about that because I hadn't heard about putting, you know, just artificial bone. I don't know if they were talking about artificial ankle or...
Yeah, he was talking about an artificial ankle, which is still to some degree in the experimental stages. There have been a number of clinical trials in America, but so far... the jury's just a little bit out on which is the best ankle to use. So
The
point is you don't need that because right now you essentially have a problem where you have some hardware that needs to come out. But just because the doctor said probably or maybe won't need to be, there's always the little wiggle room there.
Uh-huh.
And it sounds like if it's getting loose and it's bothering you, you should just have it taken out. It's a simple procedure.
And it won't affect my foot in the future?
Not if it felt that good after you initially healed. In other words, it sounds like you've healed. You've just got something working its way loose.
It's actually, I mean, it was always the pain. Like, the pain was always there. I've been, it progressively got worse, pretty much. Like, it got better to a point. It never got better that
I
was walking normally.
In that case, then, you need to make sure that your bone is truly healed. The doctor needs to take a CT scan and really find out if every bit of that bone is healed. Now, that could be an issue. Maybe it isn't the hardware getting loose. It could be that you didn't heal. I'm sort of getting a different picture now from what you were telling me earlier. So once that is proven, then it's easy to take out the hardware and there's little risk. But if it isn't healed, you may need to leave the hardware in and you may need to have the doctor put you on a bone stimulator to get that bone to heal.
Okay. I didn't even know about that. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I'll talk to my doctor about that.
Good luck.
Thank you for your help.
All right. Thank you very much. Podiatry is our topic. Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, our guest, 848-4425, and the 510 area code is our number. Our next caller is Ann from Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Yes. Hi. Thanks for taking my call. I have a lump on the back of my ankle right in the Achilles heel area, and it's progressively, well, it's sort of materialized over the last 6 months, and about 25 years ago, I was standing on some big boulders, and they slipped, and my foot fell down in between them, and they sort of wedged my ankle, and there's a kind of an indentation to this day right above the lump from those boulders.
Uh-huh.
And I'm just wondering, you know, and it's painful to the touch, and at times the pain very recently has gotten worse, and it's almost radiated up my leg.
Now, does it feel to you like when you feel that lump that is down on your heel bone where the Achilles attaches, or just up in your Achilles where it's free?
It's up in my Achilles.
Okay, so what has happened is the initial injury that you had took away some of the flexibility of your Achilles tendon.
Uh-huh.
And over the years, with you aging and so forth, and I'm not saying you're old, but as you progress through your years, that loss of flexibility has created some partial tearing further down towards your heel bone from that. And that's what you have there, is you have a little wad of scar tissue.
Okay.
And that is typically pretty easy to treat with physical therapy. I order deep friction massage and ultrasound on those things. And with most patients, in about 2 months, you can make that get, if not totally gone, at least down to an acceptable level. Now, the one thing to warn you about is don't let anybody give you a shot of cortisone in that scar tissue.
Okay.
Because that can weaken your tendon and it can rupture. And that's, it's sometimes, unfortunately, commonly done by doctors who don't deal a lot with the foot and ankle.
Uh-huh.
But get in to see a podiatrist and ask them if they can go ahead and prescribe, or maybe in their own office they can do physical therapy for you.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Sure.
All right, let's go to Angela. You're on About Health.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call. For about 2 years now, I've been wearing this spacer between my big toe and the second toe, and I was diagnosed with having not a physiological bunion, but the pain from one. And I've been wearing it for over 2 years now, and I'm wondering if I'm going to have to break down and have surgery, or if this is something that's going to eventually get better.
Angela, if you look at your foot when you stand on it, does it look like you have a fallen arch type of foot?
I actually have very high arches, and I wear not a podiatrist type of insert, but I wear a pretty good insert from REI.
If you have a high arch, you don't need an insert anyway, then. Other than just for shock absorption. So tell me about
the pain. Well, it seems like the pain gets better when it goes away when I wear the insert as well as the spacer.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. In other words, the insert that you're using is probably just providing shock absorption, but it's not providing, you know, like elevating your arch, which you already have a high arch.
Uh-huh.
So my question to you is this. When you feel the pain, where do you perceive it? Does it feel like it's inside the joint?
Well, actually, that whole bone bump there is so painful I can barely touch it most of the time.
Okay. That sounds like you need to talk to somebody about a surgical consultation then. I mean, it sounds like it's getting to the point where it's potentially going to start limiting your lifestyle.
Well, it does, actually. I have a hard time exercising and going to the gym and walking, and I used to just be a massive walker, and I can't do that now.
Now, this is time to go see somebody. And
the reason why I'm asking all this, too, sorry to interrupt you, is that it is getting better, believe it or not. I mean, the pain is a lot better than it used to be, so I'm wondering if...
But are you still limiting your lifestyle?
Yes.
Well, that's the answer. I mean, if you give it, say, 60 days more and you get back to where you used to be, I'd say, well and good. If not, go see somebody. I mean, you know, it's not going to hurt to have somebody look at you.
Well, he did, and he said that I probably would have to have surgery. And then I got such, opposing opinions about that I just thought, okay, well, let me just jam something between these toes and stretch it and try and wait. And
well, the good news, what you've done hasn't hurt anything, and even letting some time go by hasn't hurt anything. But in my practice, the average patient that has a bunionectomy where we have to fracture a bone, reset it, remove the bunion, they have no hardware put in the foot. It's literally about a 17 to 19-minute operation. You're on crutches for a week and a half. The average patient at 5 weeks is back doing aerobic activity, weight-bearing. So if you have to have that done, I don't think you need to fear it so much. But I like you, if you think it's getting better, it's not unreasonable to give it 60 days and see what happens.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Let's go to Michelle in Fresno. You're on About Health.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi. I have a problem when I wake up in the morning. My feet are really swollen, and then when I step on them, they feel like not a ripping, but a splitting on the bottom of my feet.
Michelle, are your feet actually, do they actually look more swollen when you get up in the morning than when you went to bed at night?
No, they feel more swollen.
Okay. And do you get symptoms when you lie down after the first hour or so?
I'm usually asleep by then.
I'm sorry?
I'm usually asleep by then.
Okay, so nothing keeps you up, in other words?
No.
It sounds like you could potentially be experiencing an early symptom of plantar fasciitis. I'm not sure about that feeling of swelling. You may have to have some, you know, a podiatrist see you, and they may have to do some neurologic testing on you. But the runner stretch that we talked about earlier in the program, where you lean into the wall, keeping your one heel down at a time, and lower yourself towards the wall and stretching your calf muscle, should be helpful for your symptoms initially. But because there's a potential of a neurologic component to your problem, I think you ought to see a podiatrist and have them work you up for that.
Oh, okay. All right, then. Thank you.
You bet.
All right, let's go to Berkeley and talk to Andrew. You're on About Health.
Yes, I'm calling for my wife, actually. She had a serious ankle injury a year or so ago. She's still has hardware in the ankle, so I'm feeling that that needs to be removed before she can make any real progress. Do you agree?
Not necessarily. In other words, at this point in time, you're not happy with her progress and she's not happy with it?
Oh, certainly not, but I don't think that's unusual.
Yeah, the question is, though, what is it? What symptom is she having?
Limited mobility, continuous pain, and general inability to...
General malaise. So, and the thing is, the doctor has reassured you that the bones have healed?
That's a good question.
Okay. First thing is, find out if the bones have healed. That's number one, because it's not that uncommon that you'll have a picture exactly like you're painting, and in fact, the bones haven't healed. Next thing is, if the bones have healed, then I would consider getting rid of the hardware, and I'd consider having someone do an arthroscopic examination of the ankle, which is relatively simple. We put in a little 4-millimeter scope, and we look around in there and correct little deviations that we can find from however the ankle was set. So job one, find out if the bone's healed. If, in fact, it is healed, then consider having the hardware removed and have an arthroscopic examination performed.
Excellent. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
All right. 848-4425 is our number and the 510 area code. We're talking about foot problems with Dr. Mike DiGiacomo. Dr. DiGiacomo, take some time and give us your number in case people don't get a chance to talk to you on the phone.
Sure. We're in Oakland. The number is 510-465-8012.
All right. We'll go. You repeat it again for us.
Sure. It's 510-465-8012.
All right, let's go to Berkeley. Talk to Brother John. You're on About Health. Brother John? All right, then let's go to Lucy in Sonoma. You're on About Health.
Hi, thank you. I had an injury to my big toe on my right foot about 18 months ago. I kicked somebody who was an assailant. And when I landed up in the hospital, they were stitching up my head. But I kept saying, my foot really hurts, my foot really hurts. And what I've got is numbness on the top of the big toe and on the top of the second toe. And so as a result, it's been bending, creating what some doctors say, oh, well, that's a bunion. But a bunion, is that the right word?
Well, I'll tell you what. First of all, I'm very sorry to hear that happened to you. The second thing is that when you jammed the big toe, hello?
No, we can still hear you, Mike.
Okay, good. When you jammed the big toe, unfortunately, you probably created a little divot, much like a golfer would hit it, make a divot in the golf course, in the cartilage on the big toe. And what that does, it creates an irregularity in such a way that when the big toe moves, it eventually starts forming a spur on top of the big toe. The big toe is called the hallux. And the condition is called hallux limitus. So you don't really get a bunion. You get what's called a dorsal or on top of the foot bunion. That, in turn, puts pressure on the nerve that innervates or gives sensation to toes number one and toes number two. That condition probably will require some kind of a minor surgical intervention, but it's just simply a spur removal, a very simple thing.
All right. Well, sorry, we lost you. If you have further questions, please call us back. Let's go to me and Ronan Park. You're on About Health.
Hi, thank you for taking my call. I have a question. Sometimes when I wake up, actually it happens pretty frequently, I will go to step and it'll be kind of painful. And what will happen is I'll have to snap or twist my ankle in place so that I can walk on it.
And this has happened for how long now?
Oh, sometimes it comes and goes, but it's been steady for at least 10 years.
Do you ever have a day when you get out of bed and you don't have to do it?
No.
Okay. Now, this is complete conjecture because yours is a little bit of an unusual condition, but you may have taken and created a little bit of a tear of the cartilage in your ankle.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get into a certain position, that tear can kind of flop into a different position and create an impingement.
Uh-huh.
When you're in a certain position, and you have to shake it out, so to speak. This happens in the knee sometimes. It'll actually lock up a knee sometimes.
I'll have to do that in my knee as well.
Okay.
And it's on different parts of the foot. It's not just the ankle. It could be the big toe or the little toe.
Yeah, it could be that one of the bigger joints, though, is creating the lockup, and you're having to move everything else to make it work.
Right.
But this one is one that probably just an x-ray alone isn't going to give you the answer. The doctor needs to see an x-ray, but they may also need to do an MRI. And if the condition warrants something that important, or if it's that important of a condition as far as what it's creating with your lifestyle, you may have to have an arthroscopic examination of the joint. which is simple. They put a scope in and take a look around and see if they can fix the problem.
Well, one of the questions I have is that sometimes I'll be walking on a level surface, and then all of a sudden my foot will just kind of get out.
Yeah, and that too sounds like it goes with the picture that I'm envisioning, and that would be where you have not only something going on with the cartilage in the ankle, but probably what's called the anterior talofibular ligament, the ligament that supports the ankle on the outside. It's the keystone to holding your ankle together.
Anterior,
I wouldn't be a bit surprised.
Anterior tibial ligament?
Anterior, talo, T-A-L-O, fibular, F-I-B-U-L-A-R, ligament.
Okay.
And I wouldn't be a bit surprised if on an MRI exam they find both of those things in there.
Okay, thank you.
You bet.
All right, let's go to Randy in Redwood City. You're on About Health.
Hi, how you doing today?
Good.
Good. Hey, listen, I used to have to wear corrective shoes when I was a young child. I had the bad habit of standing on the outer part of my, ankles. My ankles became really weak. And, in high school, I sprained my ankles several times on both sides. But now as I'm getting older, I recently purchased a pair of orthotic for my shoes, and I'm just having a problem with the weakness on the outer part of the ankle. And I was just wondering if you have any suggestions that I could do to, help, because I can't even squat down for a long time.
Sure. Well, first thing is, your foot is probably, as we've talked about earlier in the show, more of a high arch type of foot, and that's the type of foot that goes to the outside, and that's the type of foot that sprains ankles easily. This is not the foot where an arch support helps. So if someone in a shoe store or a doctor prescribes, in quotes, an orthotic or an arch support, usually it's pretty counterproductive to helping you. What you need is to get into a podiatrist who will then hopefully get you into a program of strengthening the outer leg muscles called the peroneal muscles.
Right.
And they need to put you on some TheraBand strengthening. And to get that overly bulked up compared to the inner muscle, which is the posterior tibial muscle, this would require diligent exercise for about 90 days minimum at about 3 to 4 times a week to bulk up that outer ankle and to make that thing more stable. Now, you could have literally almost like a reverse orthotic made for your shoe, not at all like an arch support, but something that puts a wedge to the outer side and makes you tip inward. But our joints in the ankle and heel are not designed in such a way that can work terribly well. So for you, I think the main thing is physical medicine.
Okay, thank you so much.
Sure.
All right, Lucia's back from Sonoma. She we cut her off inadvertently. Continue, Lucia. You can still have more questions.
Thank you. Yes, I do. It seems, I did hear what you said on the radio. It seems that this bunion-like thing, it goes out to the side. It's not on the top, so I don't know that it's a spur. We had talked about it. It's an injury.
Yes, and you could also have a traditional bunion developing there, too, because in the process of injuring the toe, as I was conjecturing, I was saying that you may have created a divot in your cartilage, you recall?
A divot in my cartilage. Okay, no,
right.
I didn't hear that part.
Okay, that's kind of right where the phone cut off. And then you could have also injured the ligament on the side of the big toe, which would be next to your other foot. And that ligament is the thing that helps integrity and makes the toe stay straight.
Mm-hmm.
And so this limitation of motion and the off-tracking that you're getting can be creating all of this symptom complex.
So what could the remedy be? Can I use, I was prescribed an orthotic, which was that tear-shaped thing to support the metatarsal, and I used that, and sometimes that was good, but sometimes it hurt.
Well, that's one step. The next thing is to have some physical therapy on the thing, whereby they try to do some gentle range of motion exercises and see if they can try to straighten that toe a little bit and stretch the inner ligament that wasn't injured.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And that is step two. So after that, if that doesn't work, then you're pretty much looking at living with it or having some surgical intervention.
Okay. I'll go through the first two and see what I can do with that.
Good luck.
Right, thank you so much.
848-4425 is our number, the 510 area code. We have some open lines and a little bit of time. So let's go to Anna. You're on About Health.
Hi. Hello?
Hello. It's your turn.
Yes, thank you. I'm a letter carrier, and so I walk most, 4 hours a day, on and off. And I've developed, a pain in the right heel.
Uh-huh.
And so it's like I've been massaging my foot and I've been trying to change shoes. I've been in a carrier for almost 20 years now. And I've had a problem maybe 3 years ago, and then I changed shoes and it was with the air soles, and that seemed to help. But then I switched back different, I couldn't find the shoe again, and then I started, paining. Is massaging help, or what else can I do
Anna, if you were listening to the show earlier, we were talking about the runner stretch or the Achilles tendon stretch. And if you didn't get that, you want to call my phone number, and we will send you a copy of a sheet that will instruct you on it. It's 510-465-8012. And that will actually illustrate to you how to do this runner stretch. So number one, runner stretch. Number two, make sure you wear shoes with a bit of heel elevation to them. For instance, if you had a chance to wear either a sneaker or a running shoe, the running shoe's better because it's got more heel to it.
Okay.
A work boot versus a flat loafer is better. The aerosoles were okay, but they could even be higher yet. The next thing is to get an orthotic from a podiatrist made for your foot and have you also do some physical therapy. If all else fails, then the podiatrist would want to put you into one of these cam walkers or large boot type things for about a month. And if and that means you'd be sitting, obviously, on the job. Next thing, if you got, you know, to the point where all that didn't work for you, then this Ositron treatment with shockwave therapy would be the way to go.
All right, thank you for that question. Let's go to Berkeley, talk to Brother John. You're on About Health.
Hello, Doc. I'm 70 years old, 170 pounds, 5'11", moderate high blood pressure for 45 years, and I have reached the point, even though I try to do some yoga, that I cannot do any yoga. If, in fact, I get lie down, the only way I can get up is by using my arms to lift me up. I've been wearing thongs for 35 years, if I didn't say that. When I get up, sometimes my feet are cold at night, and when I get up in the morning, in fact, all the time, my feet are purple.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you've got a couple of things going on. One of them could be arterial, which would mean that you've got some hardening of the arteries or peripheral arterial disease, PAD. And the thing is with the blue is that it's one of two things. Either you're cold and your body is putting your blood vessels into spasm, trying to make the blood go away from your extremities, going into your core and heat it up.
Right.
Or you could have bad veins, which means that you're not getting blood return from your extremities. So do you have any varicose veins if you look down at your legs?
No.
Okay. Probably the first, it could be that the you need to be warmer when you're sleeping. You may be keeping your environment a little too cold, and you may be having what we call vasospasm or spasm of the blood vessels, creating that blue. But your condition warrants, I think, you know, an actual exam by a podiatrist. So I think I'd look to your health care provider to get you into a podiatrist and have further examination to find out if, in fact, you have arterial insufficiency as well.
Are you a podiatrist?
Yes.
Do you take Medi-Cal?
Sure. You can give us a call.
Okay. I'll have my doctor make out a prescription for you today, I'll make an appointment. Okay? Thank you very much.
Certainly. All right. Let's go to Santa Rosa. Talk to Stan. You're on About Health.
Hello, doctor. Firstly, you're a wonderful communicator, and it's a pleasure to listen to you. It's a wonderful program. Number one, on my left foot, the area behind the toes, which usually, I'm in my 70s, by the way, usually we would have a soft, fleshy pad. That seems to be have gone, and the contact with anything, even a well-padded shoe or a rug, anything, creates a lot of discomfort, and I've lived with it, but I do a lot of exercises of a variety, and the more exercise I do, the better it feels. However, I can't get rid of this sort of bumpy, not quite sharp crystal feeling under there or calcium, but
sure.
There's some material under there that seems not to have gone away through the years, and I can't get rid of it.
Well, our job is to keep you active, so let's see if we can figure this out. If you look down at your feet, do your toes bend upward like what we call a hammer toe?
At the moment, no. If I extend my foot and I tighten my calf, then the toes will pull up into that effect. But otherwise, my arches are flat as a pancake for the most part, have been all my life.
What happens is there are one of two ways that you lose that fat pad under the ball of your foot. One way is if you develop hammer toes. What happens is the toes sort of contract upward, and they drag the fat pad away from where the weight bearing is, and it just dissipates. It just doesn't help you anymore. And so the crunchy feeling that those people get is literally the bottom of the knuckle bone and what we call the volar plate. It's a hard cartilage plate underneath the knuckle bone.
Yes.
In the other scenario is, I hate to say this, but it's just the aging process where you've just had a dissipation of the fat pad down there.
Is that replaceable?
And unfortunately, it's not. There was a doctor in Philadelphia about 6 years ago that came up with a device to basically suck some fat out of the belly or out of the butt or wherever and injected into that area, but it never lasted very long because it's not encapsulated, so it just dissipated within a few weeks. So the only thing we can do in that case is something from the external, just have a soft orthotic made for you.
I see.
And this can be made of a gel or any sorts of other materials, and, you know, that'll just be in the shoe, and that'll keep you active.
does glucosamine have any benefit towards this?
In this condition, probably not. As I stated earlier, though, I do believe in it. I've seen medical studies, and Dr. Lenore can allude to this as well, but it definitely is good for knee preservation or cartilage of the knee.
I see.
But we don't have any studies for the foot so far.
Well, lastly, thank you. What is Raynaud's disease? I went to a doctor years ago. He said I had this condition, but with a lot of exercise and attention to my feet, bathing hot, cold, and manipulation of my ankles, my toes, and manually, etc., it seems to have literally gone away. What is Raynaud's disease? Because it wasn't defined.
Sure.
It was incurable.
Raynaud's is a symptom complex whereby a person's autoimmune response to cold is to, and the normal response is you get cold, then the blood vessels in your toes, your fingers, your nose, and your ears basically clamp down. They send blood to the core part of your body. It gets warm, comes back down. You get a mechanism that says, okay, we got warm blood here. Open up and let the warm blood come in.
Mm-hmm.
In the Raynaud's patient, what happens is the cold is the stimulus. The response is shunt the blood to the core. The stimulus never goes away. And you can't get the warm blood back. And I literally, and I'm practicing in Oakland, California, literally will have 1,000 patients every winter that get frostbite
mm-hmm.
because of Raynaud's, and they've never left Oakland.
Really?
So, when we had our energy crisis a year or two ago, in the wintertime, a lot of older people, especially for economy reasons, were cutting their heat down. And we were seeing a number of people in that circumstance. But it's just an over, active mechanism that would ordinarily be a normal mechanism.
Keeping is there a food supplementation program that might in some way improve?
Niacin may be of some benefit. Niacin is a vasodilator.
Mm-hmm.
And if you wanted to just try something over the counter, niacin definitely could be of some benefit for trial. Some people get kind of a pruritic or an itchy reaction when they first start it, but it usually goes away after a few days.
Mm-hmm. I see. And lastly, and I appreciate your goodwill, the small and abundant blood vessels on the lower portion of the leg are quite apparent. They're not extended, they don't bulge, but there's just a rash of them on both feet, and I was wondering if what does that indicate?
Well, that indicates
around the ankles and in that locale.
Yeah, the valves in the veins, the bigger blood vessels that return blood to your heart higher up in your leg, are having what we call a little bit of incompetency.
Mm-hmm.
And so what's happening is you're getting a bit of back pressure, and it's pushing all the way into the capillaries, and it's sort of starting to blow those out a little bit.
How might that be improved, please?
You are walking as much as you can walk, it sounds like. You're keeping your weight relatively normal.
Yes,
the only
very
other
low,
thing,
matter of fact. I keep my weight low.
Good. The only other thing, though, is wearing support hose. And I advocate knee-high support hose. You can go into a department store and buy them.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, I wear them every day because I stand long hours.
Mm-hmm.
And they really control that situation well.
I see. Thank you so much.
Certainly.
All right. Thank you very much. Well, unfortunately, Dr. Giacomo, we've run out of time again. Let's get the number for those people who have still questions and might want to call.
Sure. In Oakland, it's 510-465-8012.
All right. So thanks very much, Dr. Giacomo. Tonight, I want to remind our audience and you as well that we're having an open forum on KMTV Television, Channel 32. We're talking about ethnic health disparities, focusing on the African-American community. If you want to listen, look at us and even talk to us, and then that's available to you, Channel 32 at 9 p.m. So I'd like to thank Ranjita Geisler for all the new technology I've been provided, as well as for the scheduling. Russ for helping me with this. I think this is going to be a real welcome addition to our program. I'd like to thank the members of the Ethnic Health Institute for the support that they consistently give us. But most of all, I'd like to thank you for joining us on another edition of About Health. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. We'll talk again next week.
Oakland School tracks African children into the prison, the military, or the grave. Now that the state of California has taken away all local control of education in Oakland and wants to close 5 black community schools, taking back our community's future from miseducation to community control will take place on Saturday, March 13th from noon to 6 p.m. at the Uhuru House, 7911 MacArthur Boulevard in Oakland. Uhuru means freedom. Let's get organized. Call 569-9620. That is 569-9620. After story had never been told,
so now you see. This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno. It's 1 o'clock. Please stay tuned for Free Speech Radio News.